William Morrow and Harper Audio present Resistance, How Women Saved Democracy from Donald Trump by Jennifer Rubin, read by Hillary Huber. A note before we begin. For a list of sources, be sure to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/resistance. I stand on their shoulders. Others stand on mine. I know my responsibility. Nancy Pelosi on the suffragettes. From her 2019 Time 100 interview. Women belong in all places where decisions are being made. It shouldn't be that women are the exception. Associate Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg on the elevation of Sonia Sotomayor. Preface. Especially for women, Donald J. Trump's 2016 election came as a bolt out of the blue, a jolt that left them personally wounded, fearful, and angry. They had expected so much better from the American electorate. Demagogues had run for president before, but had been kept at bay. Huey Long, George Wallace, and Father Coughlin never came close to winning national elections. Nevertheless, tens of millions of voters had embraced an abjectly ignorant, racist, and unfit huckster. His negative attributes had not disqualified him in their eyes, but rather they endeared him to them. His election unnerved the daughters of the 1960s and 1970s, who had seen uneven but forward progress for women on so many fronts. The election of a man nostalgic for the unliberated 1950s undermined their faith in their fellow Americans' judgment and tolerance. The assumption that one could rely on the common sense of the American people now seemed farcical. Past gains women had once imagined permanent, such as access to safe abortions, seemed suddenly fragile. Women's confidence that legal, social, and economic advances provided a floor below which American women could not fall was called into question. The promise that women were on a path to full inclusion and equal power in all aspects of American life? That suddenly seemed like a pipe dream. In the face of this calamity, women did what they always do. They gathered to talk and commiserate, to bolster one another, to share their stories, and to begin planning. With remarkable speed, a grassroots resistance, not made exclusively, but certainly primarily of women, began to sprout. When the shock of election night wore off, millions of women faced daunting challenges: to actively engage as citizens, to elevate women's place in American politics, to continue to fight against Trump's policies, and to decry his outrages, scandals, and lies. Women exasperated by Trump's election ran for office by the hundreds. Others volunteered, raised money, or protested. In whatever role they played over the next 4 years, volunteer, activist, candidate, donor, protester, women refused to allow Trump's presidency to become the new normal. At the same time the grassroots opposition was sprouting, key women power players in the Democratic Party started to pick up the pieces after a devastating loss, infuse their organizations with new purpose, harness the energy from the grassroots, and deploy their fundraising dollars and expertise to dislodge Trump. They channeled women's anger over the confirmation of Justice Brett Kavanaugh in 2018. Their outrage over southern states' abortion bans, their horror over the grotesque mistreatment of migrant families and children, their indignation over the constant assaults on democracy, and their grief over the passing of Supreme Court Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg in 2020 into a defiant movement to deny Trump a second term. Meanwhile, in some corners of the Republican Party, lifelong conservatives were mortified that the party of Abraham Lincoln had united behind someone whose character and views represented a repudiation of everything that had attracted them to the GOP. To the shock of anti-Trump Republicans, fellow members who had once extolled the GOP as the party of ideas countenanced Trump's hostile takeover of the party, and worse, began to rationalize and defend his noxious views. Many craved access to Trump's administration and sought jobs in an executive branch led by a dangerous narcissist. While the Republican Party devolved into a cult of personality, millions of American women, both Democrats and Republicans, aghast at the 2016 election results, set out on a personal and political journey that began even before the Women's March on January 21, 2017, the largest single day of protest in American history. Democratic women not only ran, but triumphed in the 2018 midterm House races. Republican women did the same in 2020. Women candidates joined the presidential race, battling persistent media bias and gender stereotypes, and confronted many less qualified men on the debate stages. Hillary Clinton had not been the last woman to compete for the presidency, but the first for a major party. Her losing candidacy benefited the more politically adept and diverse women candidates who followed her, and enabled the election of a barrier-breaking woman vice president in 2020. The Trump era was a time of a personal triumph and political awakening for many women, and the birth of a mass movement largely headed and fueled by women. It scrambled many women's assumptions about people on the other end of the political spectrum, forged new friendships, and encouraged the formation of new networks. Women reinvigorated the Democratic Party and threw the Republican Party back on its heels. The political storm that gained steam over 4 years proved as powerful as the women's movement of the 1970s and as consequential as the 1960s civil rights movement. Trump's shocking victory provoked millions of women to elevate the importance of politics in their daily lives, to the extreme detriment of the party Trump took over. Women's political involvement soared, and their partisan identification shifted in dramatic ways, affecting the composition of Congress, the makeup of the parties, and the language of politics. Ironically, Trump prompted many white women to prioritize gender over race. His election added impetus to political organizing among Black women, long the backbone of the Democratic Party, and among Native Americans. In the aftermath of Trump's defeat, we can now fully appreciate how millions of women transformed their own lives and recaptured our democracy from the clutches of an authoritarian bully. Defeat is an orphan, the saying goes, but victory in this case had millions of mothers. Their story is what follows. Part 1. From Dejection to Elation. Chapter 1. The Nightmare Begins. The New York Times needle, an omnipresent election tracking device on the Times website, drifted away from Hillary Clinton in the direction of real estate mogul and reality TV star Donald Trump. Gosh, how strange. Perhaps the exit polling was out of whack, or big metropolitan counties with Democratic voters had not checked in. Sitting in the Washington Post's offices, I felt a sense of panic begin to rise. By early evening on election night 2016, Trump had won Florida and, what? Michigan and Pennsylvania were too close to call. The needle fell farther into the red. 81% probability of a Clinton win became 40, then 20. My first reaction, akin to the news of a natural disaster or grave illness in the family, was denial. It cannot be. We all saw Trump on the Access Hollywood video bragging about sexually assaulting women. America could not elect this man. The needle must be wrong. If only. When I left the Washington Post's offices on K Street just after 10 p.m., the D.C. streets were empty and oddly quiet. Waking up the next morning, I momentarily grasped at the notion that it had been a horrible nightmare, or a news reporting screw-up that put the Florida 2000 vote-counting debacle to shame. I had written a column breaking up with the Republican Party in the spring of 2016, and then poured my energy in my Washington Post opinion pieces and TV appearances to alert my fellow Americans of the dangers of electing Trump. The irony did not escape me that in the one presidential election in which I was rooting for the Democratic presidential nominee, the party blew what seemed to me and millions of other voters to be an entirely winnable race. I had been certain that Trump, if elected, would degrade our public discourse, attack democratic institutions, and govern recklessly. I saw from the start of his campaign a dangerous demagogue, someone who deployed the same tricks all despots and wannabe despots use, the big lie, the scapegoating of outsiders, the appeal of a strong man who says, "I alone can fix it." I was never convinced, however, that my thesis would be tested in the real world, let alone that the outcome would be far worse than I had dared imagine. In the wake of the election, I felt sick, and my sense of doom deepened that American democracy would be stress-tested as never before. I was even more despondent that previously normal Republicans had supported him. With his victory, Republicans could be expected to support Trump, rationalize his outrageous conduct, and pursue noxious policies he had described in the campaign. I steeled myself for the likelihood that Republicans would countenance reckless and even illegal behavior. The GOP's victory in 2016 was particularly devastating to thousands of Republican and Republican-leaning women like me, who had crossed party lines to vote for Hillary Clinton. Certainly more devastating to us than any prior defeat a GOP presidential nominee had suffered. In past presidential elections, I had voted for the losing Republican presidential candidate more than once. President George H.W. Bush in 1992, Senator John McCain in 2008, and Mitt Romney in 2012. These were decent, honorable men who deeply believed in democracy and at critical junctures in their careers had put country above party or personal gain. However, I had never feared democracy would be endangered by their defeats. Now, I felt the country was in peril. Like many who would wind up in the Never Trump camp, the informal gaggle of Republicans and ex-Republicans who would not assent to Trump's takeover of the GOP, I once had identified with moderate Republicans who were dedicated to victory in the Cold War, expanded opportunity, free trade, and robust legal immigration. In November 2016, that party seemed as extinct as the Whigs. During the campaign, I watched in horror as prominent, widely respected Republican politicians and opinion leaders succumbed to careerism, tribalism, and flat-out fabrication. Living through a political body snatchers experience, I had witnessed one conservative, intellectual, and politician after another, one respectable publication after another, rationalize, defend, and then laud a detestable figure who repudiated principles and positions that once animated these same Republicans' political lives. I had experienced firsthand Trump's misogynistic wrath during the campaign. On December 1, 2015, I wrote a column for The Washington Post in reaction to his demand that CNN pay $5 million to charity for his appearance at a Republican presidential debate. The most obvious explanation for putting forth an utterly ridiculous demand is to induce the other side to reject it, I surmised. In this case, that would give Trump, who has done worse in each successive debate, an excuse to beg off. Why is he scared of debating his competitors? I suggested that he has run out of one-liners and cannot talk extemporaneously at length, at least not rationally, about policy issues, especially foreign policy, where he has blundered in the past. This evidently struck too close to home. Trump tweeted, "Highly untalented WashPost blogger Jennifer Rubin, a real dummy, never writes fairly about me. Why does WashPost have low IQ people?" Instead of covering the MAGA crowd's bullying from afar, I was now in the middle of it, a target of his base who hurled vulgar insults by email and social media. The hate email and tweets, often threatening and anti-Semitic, rained down on me. It was a preview of what was to come for me and for scores of women when the most powerful man in the world publicly singles you out and implicitly encourages his supporters to harass and threaten you. Friends and colleagues joked that this was a sign I was relevant. I did not see it that way. I felt under siege, and worse, despondent about the presence of so many unhinged, if not deranged, Americans. I did not know, on that dreary 2016 election night, and in the days that immediately followed, that millions of women shared a mixture of dread and disorientation. I had no idea their reaction to the 2016 election results would spawn a new spirit of defiance and an era of political activism. At the time, all I could feel was a sense of disorientation. I felt unmoored to either party, convinced the Republican Party had no loyalty to the country, the Constitution, or the truth. As never before, I was deeply worried about American democracy. I had thrown my all into making the case against Trump and now felt as if it had been for naught. Like virtually all mainstream media commentators, I had not for a moment imagined Trump might win. It turned out I was not alone in struggling to process what had just happened. On election night, in living rooms and at watch parties around the country, the results triggered common sensations of shock, horror, and loss for millions of women. Women shared a feeling of alienation from a country they had misjudged, a sense for the first time in their lives that American democracy was as fragile as some European countries in the 1920s and 30s. Dazed paralysis eventually would give way to anger and then to mass action. But election night itself was brutal. Two women, both major movers in the Democratic Party and the progressive movement, went to New York to take part in Hillary Clinton's victory celebration at the Javits Center on election night 2016. They traveled from Washington, D.C., to be with donors, old friends from the Clinton years, and other progressive leaders to watch the historic election results come in. Within hours of Donald Trump's victory announcement, they were forced to put aside, or at least contain their own emotions, and figure out how thousands of activists, donors, campaign operatives, and think tank scholars would readjust to the new political reality. One was Neera Tanden, longtime advisor to Hillary Clinton and a principal architect of the Affordable Care Act, ACA, in the Obama administration. She was rumored to be Clinton's future Health and Human Services Secretary and already co-chaired the Clinton transition. Raised by a single mother who, for a time after a divorce, relied on food stamps and public housing, Tanden deeply believed the Democratic Party was a friend of ordinary people and a backstop when personal tragedy struck. An Indian American who had lived the American dream, she also understood that America, despite its flaws, was a haven for immigrants. Political junkies might recognize the dark-haired, impeccably dressed progressive from her TV appearances, but her full-time job was heading the Center for American Progress, CAP, the progressive think tank and its adjacent political arm. For her, Trump's victory threatened the values and endangered the people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.